helpless man, blind from birth. The only one who saw his worth didn't pass him by. He heard his cry. He rubbed his eyes with a handful of clay. Then he said, go and wash in the pool today.
She's talking about that miracle, sitting down at the feet, tearing off the roof and coming down. Some of us don't have the faith just to tear off the roof. We want to see miracles. You got to have the faith to tear off the roof. Most of our problem is we ain't willing to do what they done at the end. They had to let it go. When they lowered him down, they had to let it go. A lot of us want God to help, but we won't let it go. Y'all hear me? I mean, I'm telling you, when she's talking, just this week, I was reading and going through all that. And I've seen everything else in there, taking everything off, way it reflects everything, get stuff out of the way, that way God can move in, just get somebody to Jesus. But the one thing that we forget to notice in that scripture is they had to let him go. You imagine that was a burden that they carried for a long time to get to Jesus. Some of us been carrying something for a long time, wonder why we ain't getting the help that God promises to get. It's because we won't let it go. You give it to the Lord, you got to let it go. Amen. I appreciate the testimonies. Open your Bibles up, if you will, this morning to 2 Samuel chapter number 14. 2 Samuel chapter number 14. Some of you know the story. To kind of put it in understanding this morning, in this scripture you find out that there was a son of David's by the name of Absalom that had killed Amnon simply because his half-sister was actually raped. He had raped his half-sister, and Absalom had got upset. He's mad, and David comes and he has a desire to be able to have his family together. But for about three and a half years, give or take, Absalom was on the run. He had left. We have to agree that he committed something that was really beyond someone's forgiveness and somebody's understanding. But at the same time, Amnon had committed something that really was beyond somebody's comprehension to be able to rape somebody. But Absalom had chose to be able to take it in his hands, and because of that, he's now running for 3 years. David comes to this portion of Scripture, and he begins to talk. And in this story, you find that there's a lady that he encounters, that he speaks to, of Tekoa. The Bible says in verse number 4, when the woman of Tekoa spake to the king, she fell on her face to the ground and did and said, "Help, O king." And the king said unto her, "What aileth thee?" She answered, "I am indeed a widow woman, and my husband is dead." She begins to tell a story that you later find out that is a story that is made up. You go down and look at verse number 11, if you will, and read a few verses. The Bible says, "Then said she, I pray thee, let the king remember the Lord thy God, that thou wouldest not suffer the revengers of blood to destroy any more, lest they destroy my son." And he said, "As the Lord liveth," this is a response to her son actually killing someone. This is his response, how the king is going to respond to this son killing. He said, "As the Lord liveth, there shall not be one hair of thy son fall to the earth." In other words, he will be removed of the guilt. There will be no consequence. He will be forgiven, if you will. The Bible says in verse number 12, "Then the woman said, Let thine handmaid, I pray thee, speak one word unto my lord the king." After he gives her this word, and he says, "Don't worry, your son will be forgiven." She says, "Well, can I be permitted to say just one thing to you?" He says there in the latter part of verse number 12, and he said, "Say on." Verse number 13, "The woman said, Wherefore then hast thou sought such a thing against the people of God? For the king doth speak this thing as one which is faulty. And in that the king doth not fetch home against his banished. For we must needs die, and are as water spit on the ground, which cannot be gathered up again. Neither doth God respect any person, yet doth he devise means that his banished shall not expel from him." Here you see this woman that she stops. She listens to how the king, being David, says that we're definitely going to be able to forgive him without any question. And she says, "Well, now that you have told me that," later do we understand that this woman had made up this story to be able to see the king's approach to this. Here's why: because literally, he was trying everything to be able to get his family back together, but he would not forgive his son for killing. Absalom was one who actually killed, and David would not forgive. So she makes up this story. She says it. And when the king David actually says to her that he will be forgiven, not one hair shall fall to the ground, she says to him, "Well, can I just say one thing for just 1 second?" And then you hear in the words where David says, "Say on."
And in other terms, what she really says is this. She says, I have something against you because you failed to do in your own family what you're willing to do in mine. What do you mean by that, Brother Jason? In other words, this woman was almost, in a sense, calling out this man as he had spoke because she says, I've got something to be able to say. And the reason is I don't understand because it's almost like you are one way one moment and another way another moment. You are almost hypocritical in your stand. Well, what is your stand? She says, you're willing to be able to do for my family what you will not do for your own. What are you talking about? We're talking about forgiveness. See, it's amazing how many of us are willing to be able to forgive so many other people, but we're not willing to be able to forgive somebody in our own family. We're not willing to forgive somebody, not even in our own family, but somebody that was close to us. And I remind you that we in this church body, that we are family, we will forgive a drunkard or somebody out here, a neighbor that cusses us and look over their faults and failures. But God forbid that we'd ever forgive one another. And see, I'm just like this lady. When you and I look at one another, it's hard for us to understand how we can forgive so many other people, but we cannot forgive our own. Does that make sense to you? She says, here you will forgive somebody you've never even known, but you won't even forgive somebody that you do know. I want to ask you this question. Is there somebody like that in our life this morning? Is there somebody in your past that has done you wrong, hurt you, or hurt your children, or come against you, said something about you that has rubbed you the wrong way, and maybe even cost you something, and here you are today, you're moved on, you say you moved on, but the truth be told, you'll overlook everybody else's fault, but you won't overlook theirs. You won't forgive them, you won't move on. You won't let go, and the problem is because you still hold it over their head. There's still a mark by their name, and you're wondering why you and I do not have victories because we still stay in a marriage that we don't forgive our spouse. We'll forgive somebody in the church, or we'll forgive somebody at the job, but we won't forgive our spouse. Is that really what forgiveness is all about? See, forgiveness is a real thing. The story of this chapter is not about Absalom, whether or not he deserves it. The story of this chapter is whether or not David will actually give the forgiveness that needs to be given. I will say this to you and I'll move on. Later on, I'll even jump ahead of myself for a moment. There's no such thing as anybody ever deserving forgiveness. There's no such thing. If somebody done wrong, there are consequences for it. But based upon this scripture, he had proven that he can look beyond somebody's faults. How can we look beyond somebody else's faults? But there's certain people in our life that we can't get past theirs. We don't ever change. We stay the same way. We live the same way. And in the Bible, when you study the Word of God, you realize that forgiven was actually put in the Word of God over 40 times forgiven. You know, that word matters a lot to me. And you want to know why? Because when I'm not thinking about forgiving somebody else, I got to stop for a moment and thank God that I am forgiven. I'll say amen 100 times. I remember who I was before Jesus Christ came to where I was. I remember the man that I was. I remember the words that I said, the sin that was in my life, how I treated people and the way that I would respond to people, the way that they treated me. I know how low I was, but I'm glad to be able to stand and say that I'm not just thinking that I'm saved and I maybe hope that I'm saved, but I know without a doubt today that I can stand to say that the Lord Jesus Christ died for me, and because of Christ, thank God, God has forgiven me. And if you're sitting in the same place this morning, you ought to be grateful that God has forgiven you as well. But here's the question. How can we experience forgiveness, but we can't give it to nobody else? How can we be so undeserving and know that I am forgiving, but we can't forgive somebody else? How can we be granted forgiveness, but we can't grant forgiveness to somebody else? How can we experience the love and the mercy and the grace of God when God was done wrong by us, but we can't forgive somebody else that's done us wrong? Forgiveness is an issue that has split homes, marriages, churches, families, kids, Christian people going every separate way because they ain't ain't ever got to the place to where they learn how to forgive somebody. I hate to bust our bubble, but there ain't one person in here that's perfect. Every single one of us has done somebody wrong. And if that ain't the case, there's somebody you and I have done wrong, and it's the Lord Jesus Christ himself. But aren't you glad that Jesus never looked at us and said, I'm not going to go another mile, and I'm going to stop where I am. But as the Bible says that he came to be able to minister, that he died, he gave himself a ransom for many. He hung on the cross and he rose on the third day. But as he sat on the cross, he didn't lash out at them, but it was the people that spat on him and cursed his name. And by the way, you and me, we were the one that put him on the cross. And do you know the words of our Savior? Father, forgive them. Tell me how we can experience forgiveness, but we can't forgive somebody else. You tell me why we can come to a place to where somebody does us wrong and it just seems to be deemed unforgivable. About a month ago, there was a local preacher that had written me off, and some things had happened and didn't talk. And I was with Tiffany, and we was actually riding down the road, and we went to go eat. It was after church, and this gentleman had called me. And he called me and he said, Brother Jason, he began to talk. He's a local pastor. And he said, I just want to tell you, I'm sorry. God put it on my heart this week. And I listened to what he said. I said, you don't owe me no apology. It's completely okay. He said, yeah, because this and this and this and this happened. Well, I said, don't worry about it. It'll be fine. And we would end up fellowship. We hung up the phone, and you would think that I would be boastful. I was grateful, but we'd say, well, I knew he was going to call me. That wasn't the case. You want to know what happened? The Holy Ghost pricked my heart. And the Holy Ghost pricked my heart. He still asked me again one more time, though I've done it before and probably you have too. But he asked me that one question. Who's the last person that you have swallowed your pride and called them and said for the first second, I just want you to know that I'm sorry? Who's the last person that you picked up the phone and called and said, hey, I know you might not know about it, but because of some things that happened in my life, I had done you wrong, I'd said some things, and you apologized and said I'm sorry. And I want to ask you the same question. When's the last time that you picked up the phone and called somebody and apologized because of something that you had done wrong? When's the last time that you had forgave somebody? You know why we don't really do it much? Listen, because pride settles in, and it's hard for us to learn how to forgive. And the amazing thing to me, and I say this quite often, the reason why we have such a hard time to ask for forgive or give forgiveness for somebody else is because some of us has forgotten what it feels like to be forgiven. We've got so good at dressing up, carrying a Bible, singing in the choir, coming to Sunday school and doing everything else. We've forgotten what it's like to be forgiven. Are you understanding me? Some of you probably had liquor on your breath whenever you got saved. You was cussing before you walked into church. Hey, some of you were in a hog pen sitting somewhere where nobody thought you could ever be saved, running around, and you made a mockery of your life and made a mess of your life. But yet Jesus showed up to where you was. You ought to be thankful today that you're saved. Some of us have forgotten about the way that our lives were and our homes were and our marriages were. We've forgotten about the way that we were living every single day, not just some days, but every single day. And if we would ever get back to the place that we'd realize what it was really like when we got forgiven, I would dare say it'd be a lot easier for us to forgive somebody now. So I want to ask you this next question. Have you forgotten? Have you forgotten? Who's the last person that you forgave or last person that you reached out to restore the relationship? I'm going to give you five quick principles this morning about forgiveness that I see right here in the text. Number one, you can write it down. No one ever deserves it. When you're talking about forgiveness, no one ever deserves it. The Bible says in verse number 11, when you read it, listen, the Bible, she said it. She begins to talk and he says, as the Lord liveth, he said, there shall not one hair of thy son fall on the earth. Now here you are, you got three different stories that are in this. Forgiveness is something that's here. It's given, but it does not have to be. The three stories that you see in here is about this mother and her son, about what's going on. But by the way, it is made up. It's also about David and Absalom. And also you see God in us. And there's nowhere in the text where you realize that anybody ever deserved it. That's not what the case is. But based upon the law, the son should have been dead. Based upon the law, listen, Absalom should be dead. Hey, based upon the law, you and I should be dead. Do you hear what I'm trying to tell you today? Nobody deserves forgiveness. But how many times have we said they don't deserve it? Not the way they done my family. Not the way they done my kids. Not because of what they said to me. They don't deserve forgiveness. Nobody deserves forgiveness. And the devil is splitting everything wide open today because we're standing around thinking about what we deserve. And if the truth be told, if we all got what we deserved, every single one of us would be in hell today. You say it's hard to forgive. I never said it was easy. But I did say this, that based upon the scripture, just as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven us, that we for Christ's sake ought to forgive somebody else whether they deserve it or not. So I want to ask you, who is it that's in your mind? Who is it that's in your mind? If you notice in the text, she says there, if you go down a little bit, in verse number 11, she says, the Lord remember. Notice the text there. She said, I pray thee, let the king remember the Lord. He said, how can you forgive? Let the king remember the Lord. She said, in other words, David, do you not remember when you killed Uriah? How the Lord forgave you? How can you not forgive somebody else? Do you not forget the time that God forgave you for Bathsheba? If God can forgive you, why can you not forgive somebody else? You didn't deserve it, David. You did not deserve it. And you know what God's telling us today? Every single one of us, we don't deserve it either, but we ought to be thankful that God has forgiven us. But those of us that have somebody in our life that has done us wrong, we need to quit holding the grudges, quit holding it over their head. And even as we get to the place where we feel like it's not even something that can be forgivable, that we realize that something that God has done for us is beyond our comprehension. Nobody can ever explain the way God forgave us. But because God has forgiven us, we ought to forgive everybody else. And I want to ask you again, who is it? Because you know right now the Holy Ghost has already showed you somebody in your life that you're having a hard time of letting something go, and you're grieving the Holy Ghost in your life because you're so hung up on the fact that they don't deserve it when you experienced it and you think it's good for you, but you don't think it's good for somebody else. Number two, not only no one deserves it, but number two, forgiveness always comes through a mediator. The Bible says in verse number 4 that this lady came and she began to talk on their behalf. Well, we know who our mediator is. It's not a lady. It's not a person. It's the Lord Jesus himself. The Bible says, for there is one God, one mediator between God and man, Christ Jesus. It's Christ, the Christ alone. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that the righteousness of God might be made in us. Listen, Jesus Christ is the mediator. You say, how can we seek out forgiveness? How can we give forgiveness? Because of Christ and Christ alone. He is the mediator. And every single time that you forgive somebody, you look for a reason. Jesus Christ is the reason. That's the reason we ought to forgive. You know why it's silent? Because that's not the reason that we value. We want somebody to admit it. We want somebody to confess it. We want somebody to come clean. I wonder if there's anybody in the sanctuary this morning that can lift up your hand, that can say that everything you've ever done wrong, that God made you stand before the church and come clean. Is there anybody? Not one person. So why do we put such a standard on somebody else when we don't have the same standard for ourselves? You say, listen, I didn't come to hear about forgiveness. I come to hear about Jesus. It's Sunday morning. I got news for you. To me, the greatest person that lives the life of Christ is two things: somebody who loves and somebody forgives. You want to know why? Because that's something that God does all the time. He forgives all the time. And number two, he loves. The Bible says that's the greatest thing above hope and faith. Charity is the greatest of these things. You give me somebody that don't love and don't forgive, I got a hard time believing they're really as saved as they say they are. Amen. I don't care how good you look, how many skirts and dresses you wear, how many suits and tie you have, how long you carry your Bible, and how many times you go to Sunday school. You can sit on that pew and you might be what's rotting out the church because of your unforgiveness. Amen. Same thing within marriages and homes. It's dividing up. We have bitterness. So every time something turns up, we always lash out. We get mad. Why? Because we don't ever just forgive for Christ's sake. Sometimes you got to look beyond it, realize God's got a plan, and just say, you know what? Whatever God wants, I'm going to do it. But I'm going to forgive so I can move on. Why? Because I'm tired of being shackled down by this bitterness that's in my life and this hatred. If you don't learn to do it, it'll affect you. And it'll change your life. Third principle. Forgiveness always makes a way. Forgiveness always makes a way. Notice in verse number 13 and 14, the latter part of it, the key words, banished. But then he says at verse number 14, he said, devise means. In other words, it might be banished, but there's always a way to be able to come by. But there's a key word that's between both of those verse, both those words, and it's right before the word banished, and it's His. You know what that means? The Lord don't ever turn away from somebody that's His. He's going to always make a way to be able to get things back the way they should be. And somebody that loves the Lord will always make a way. Show me the person that's in here today that's the peacemaker. Not the loudmouth. Not the one that's good at arguing, putting everybody down, and calling everybody's faults out. We're not looking for that. Show me the one that's the bridge that's in the family today. Show me the one that's able to be able to calm everything down, to be able to settle everything out, and whatever it takes, they're willing to humble themselves and make themselves of no reputation. Why? Because forgiveness always makes a way. You say, yeah, but I don't want to be that person. I'm weak. Are you weak? Because that's the way Jesus lived. In my opinion, biblically, Jesus was the strongest man to ever walk the earth. There's no doubt about it. So how in the world can you and I be weak when we learn how to forgive? When you forgive, you make a way. Who's the peacemaker? And can I ask you this next question? How come it can't be us? You say, because the Lord just knows that's just how I am. I got a hard time with forgiving. Do you? Because my Bible talks about sanctification. So the more you grow closer to God, the more you become to be more like God. So if you had a hard time forgiving when you first got saved, you ought to be better at forgiving now since you have been saved. If not, you might have been saved for 20 years, but you're still a babe in Christ. You say, well, these carnal people are splitting our churches and these lost people are splitting our churches. No, it's the people that's been saved for a long time that ain't grew up in the Lord and still having a hard time forgive one another. It sucks out the unity. It sucks out the fellowship. Our family events are no longer enjoyable. It's always tiptoe at birthdays for the grandchildren and children and Christmases because there's always some kind of discord. Show me the peacemaker that's in the home. We want things to be right. We're going to have to learn to forgive. And we're going to have to learn to be able to forgive because that's the only way to be able to make a way. Listen, that's why Jesus died on the cross. He made a way for us. Thank God it is. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come through the Father but by me. He was able to be able to do it. Why? Because he moved on. He knew there had to be a substitute. Show me the hero that's in here this morning. Show me the hero that's in here this morning. You know, I can remember as a kid where my mom and dad, when they would fight, fuss, whatever it may be, I'd always go to mom or I'd always go to dad and I'd always try to water down. I'd play mediator. And we would tell kids, you just go on. You know, you don't understand. You don't know what dad done. You don't know what mom done. I understand all that. But the truth be told, they were at a place where they understood, as young as they really were, children understand, there is nothing that we should hold over each other's head that we cannot let go to be able to reconcile and restore what's going on in our home. Sometimes I've learned in the house of God, it's the youngest Christians are the easiest to forgive somebody. Amen. Forgiveness ain't a popular subject. We always want to talk about how we've been done wrong and how we've been doing this, and God knows it. Now, God don't know. He don't justify those things. That's not what happens. The truth be told, listen, this woman stepped up and she began to make a way. Somebody had to be able to save the day. Their family was being split for 3.5 years. There was already deaths and murders and people killing in this family. And all of a sudden, David was separated from his family. I mean, it's a dysfunctional family. I wonder how many of us have got a dysfunctional family. All because of unforgiveness. Willing to give somebody else something that we're not willing to give our own. Principle number 4, I'll be done, I'm close. Unforgiveness affects everybody. I want you to notice, if you will, what the Bible says in verse number 14. This is very important. The Bible says in verse number 14, For we must die. Hold on, let me go back to my scripture here. 2 Samuel chapter 4. Verse number 14, he says, "For we must needs die," he said, "and as the water spilled on the ground gathered up, neither doth God respect any persons, yet doth he devise means that he banish be not expelled from him." He talks about everyone that actually has been able to do it. Verse number 13, notice this, "And the woman said, Wherefore then hast thou thought such a thing against," notice, "the people of God." It didn't just affect them, and it didn't just affect him. It affected the people of God. Do you understand that our unforgiveness don't just affect us and 2 or 3 more? Listen to me. It affects everybody. Unforgiveness affects a youth group. Unforgiveness affects a church. Unforgiveness affects a family. Some of us may be aching. We're holding back everything that should be done because we're the one living in unforgiveness. Your unforgiveness is not just about you. It affects everybody. You say, why do you preach on something like that? Because I want the power of God in this place. I want the presence of God in this place. I want the Lord to be able to move. And you say, well, I got past that. No, just because they're not here or you don't have to see them don't mean you didn't get past it. I'm talking about letting it go. Because what you think that you conquered in your life, you haven't conquered. Because there's going to come a day where somebody's going to rub your feathers the wrong way, and that bitterness is going to show its face. And it might have happened when you was a teenager, and you were mad at mom and dad, or something had happened, or somebody had done something wrong to you. And then all of a sudden you get to be a husband or a father, and then you get to be a mom or a mother and a wife, and you find out now you're responding different than you used to respond. You want to know why? Because you've got some unforgiveness that you never let go of when you was a kid. And now it's affecting the people that's in your own home. There's no joy. There's no laughter. You bite somebody's head off and they just think, well, that's just how mom is, or that's just how dad is. That's not an excuse, friend. Our unforgiveness is affecting a lot of people. And for Christ's sake, we need to learn to forgive. The fifth thing that I would give to you would be this. Forgiveness is not from a distance. They're all right here in the text. I want you to notice what the text says, if you will, verse number 24. "And the king said, let him turn to his own house and let him," listen to this, "not see my face." That's not forgiveness. When I read the story of the prodigal son, the way I read it, the prodigal son was able to be able to come in, he clothed him, kissed him on the neck, he saw him face to face. When we get to heaven, we're going to see the Lord face to face. There's no such thing as saying you forgave somebody, but you can't look at them. There's no such thing as saying you forgave somebody as long as you keep your distance and they keep their distance. Now listen, I'm preaching to our church right here. Because we learn how to dabble whatever we want to dabble in with our family. And as long as we do our own thing and we keep ourselves, we can put on the spiritual face. But there's bitterness and it shows. And I can promise you, you cannot hide those things spiritually. It's revealing itself. When you don't think it's revealing itself, it reveals itself. When you forgive somebody, you embrace somebody. When you forgive somebody, you can co-labor with somebody. When you forgive somebody, you give all you can give the same way Christ gave all he can give for you. This principle of just existing, there's no such thing. Who's in your mind right now that you're okay as long as you don't have to see them? Who's in your past that's okay as long as you don't have to talk to them? Who's in the church that you can learn to tolerate as long as y'all don't have to really serve together in the same ministry? Who is it that you see that changes your direction? Instead of walking out this way, you walk out this way. Instead of shaking hands on that side, you shake hands on that side. Instead of going to this event, you'll go to the other event. Who is it? Who is it that happens to be talking in a circle of people at church and you'll wait till that person dismisses themselves or you go talk to that circle of people? Who is it? Friend, this is a problem. The devil's having a heyday in our churches and our homes today because of unforgiveness. We want to dress it up. We want to put some perfume or some cologne on it. We want to put a tie on it, put a dress on it. You can do whatever you want to do, but it's still flesh. And I'm sorry, but don't act like you're more holier than thou, thinking you're somebody because you can do something, but you can't forgive somebody. Spiritual temperature is not the fact that you can just do something. Spiritual temperature is seen in the way you forgive somebody. Show me how many people you forgave, and then we'll talk about how spiritual you are. Not when you can have it your way and be absent, or you can serve with one person, but you can't serve with the other person. Wait a minute, Brother Jason. This Sunday morning, we got to talk about the mission of the church. It's reaching sinners, telling people about Christ, seeing them get saved. I know. But the truth be told, listen, a lot of us have lost our effectiveness because we're still carrying this bitterness around. When people walk in, we can't serve like we used to serve. We can't minister like we used to minister because there's so much unforgiveness that's inside of us. It's happened in our churches. It's happened. I've seen it happen in senior saints. I've seen it happen in older married couples. I've seen it trickle down to their kids. I've seen it in college and career. I've seen it in teenager. And a lot of times I see it in teenagers in college and career, what's in their families. Oh, yes. It's like a north and south thing. You know what I'm saying? It's like a Yankee and a South. If you don't like them, I don't like them. Really? Is that what we're teaching our children? Is that what we're teaching? Is that the future of your church? Are you proud of that? Is that what we're proud of? As long as we can get by, I'm glad Jesus didn't treat us that way. See, we can rejoice over being forgiven, but we can't give forgiveness. It's a hard time to understand that. You say, I want a spiritual awakening. Preaching's not like it used to be. The singing's not like it used to be. It don't feel like it used to feel. Maybe it's not the church and the preaching and the singing. Maybe it's that unforgiveness that's inside of us. And I hate to say this, but some of us know this to be true. Sometimes it's not other people. Sometimes it's the Lord. And I'm not saying that. God knows my heart. I'm being humble by saying that. Some of you, some things have happened and you've been upset with the Lord because you haven't just accepted His ways are better than ours. And it has hindered your relationship with God because in your mind and in your Bible, you've read that God is loving and God is right and God is righteous. But then your family's been affected by something that has brought great pain. That's not about unforgiveness. That's about trusting the Lord. You need to trust the Lord. If I get one of you ladies at the piano, let me give you one more thing. Turn your Bibles to Psalms 130. So what is the mark of true unforgiveness? What's the mark of true forgiveness is the better way to say it. Y'all stay with me. I'm done. The Bible says in Psalms 130, not known to be David, but whoever the psalmist could be, it could be David. If not, it's something he probably lived and learned. Out of the depths I have cried unto the Lord, to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If thou, Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. Did you notice that in verse number 4? There is forgiveness. Everybody say forgiveness. There is forgiveness with the Lord. But tell me why. What's the mark of forgiveness, Brother Jason? I believe it's defined in verse number 3. Look at it with me. If thou, Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? I think the mark of forgiveness is that there is no mark. The mark of forgiveness is where you do not put a mark by somebody's name. So many of us have somebody wrong, and we put beside their name, Travis. And, oh, he cut me once. Next year something happened. Oh, that's twice. I just don't trust him. You ain't forgiven. So I'm marking him every single time. Some of us have put so many marks by somebody's name. And we say we forgave them, but that's not forgiveness. Forgiveness is not having a mark by somebody's name. It's learning to release them. And understand that God's way is perfect. And if there is a separation, if there is a divide, then it's by God's hand. It's the sovereignty of God. But don't let it be the sin of man. And please, listen to me. Don't mistaken the sin of man for the sovereignty of God. I'm going to back up a punt because some of you might not understand that. Don't mistaken the sin of man for the sovereignty of God. In other words, please do not deem your sin and my sin as that's just who God is. He had a different way. No. That's not always the case. Brother Brandon this week was preaching. And he was preaching about storms. Same mindset. We always talk about storms. I'm going through a storm. It's hard. It hurts. He says, not all storms are because of trials. Some storms are because of sin. See, the reason why a lot of things separate and divide, it ain't just because it's the sovereignty of God. Well, God just took care of that, didn't he? No, friend, sometimes it's the sin of man. Sometimes our families are divided not because of the sovereignty of God. It's because of the sin of man. Our churches, well, God got out the bad. We kept the good. Shame on us. Shame on us. That's not the sovereignty of God. It's the sin of man. And I want to ask you this morning. Would you be willing to slow down? That person that God's already put in your mind, get around this altar and ask God to forgive you for having bitterness and unforgiveness in your heart. Would you be willing to pick up the phone, call, text, and tell that person that you forgave them? Oh, no, Brother Jason, I'll ask for forgiveness, but I don't need to call them. Wait a minute. You can't forgive at a distance. See, it's easy right now as long as we got to go to the altar. Lord, it's just me, you. We talking about this. Lord, help me forgive brother so-and-so. I mean, we just want to get, praise God, I'm all right. No. You're just keeping them at a distance. What we need to do is we need to deal with it. Because we realize, listen, it don't just affect you. But it'll affect your children. And it'll affect your grandchildren. And it'll affect this church. It affects everybody. God's people should be in unity. One accord, one heart, one mind. Some of you got a mom or dad that you've been holding things over their head. Some of you got a spouse that you've been holding something over their head. Why don't you get around this altar this morning and ask God to forgive you. And give them the forgiveness that you know God has promised to you. Father, I love you.